first letter to the Corinthians.
Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord. Chapter 1 and verse 3. Fight the good fight. Timothy chapter 6.
So my subject tonight is Andrew, a soul winner. Andrew, a soul winner. And you will bear with me that when we read most of the Bible characters, and when we read also the biographies of men like Spurgeon, Hudson Taylor, David Livingstone, John Bunyan, George Muller, and so on, we feel challenged. But at the same time, we ask ourselves, could we really be at their level? And we feel deep inside our hearts exactly what John the Baptist said about Christ. We cannot step down and unloose the latchet of their shoes. Indeed, how could we imitate, how could we emulate such great men like Abraham, the friend of God, the father of believers, Moses, the meekest man, David, the man according to God's own heart, Solomon, the wisest man? How could we even be close to their knees? They are so great. Paul, the greatest theologian, the greatest apostle, who says in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, be my imitators. Peter, the rock. John, the beloved. So I'm just listing them. How could we imitate such men when we read what they have done, what they have achieved, the way they were persecuted, how they work, how they strive in serving the Lord, experiencing trials, difficulties, troubles, sicknesses, persecution, being ostracized. But they kept that focus, looking unto the Lord Jesus Christ, the author and the finisher of our faith. And the same when we read biographies, and I'm sure some of them are exaggerated, we still think, how could we match with such men, such great men? And like Paul, we are inclined to say, who is sufficient for these things? But I'm mentioning those things, and Bible characters also are not really to drive us into despair or into self-pity or to mope. That's not the purpose why we have Bible characters or we have those biographies. So no panic. We shouldn't panic when we read such a great man, Abraham, the father of believers, the friend of God, Daniel, Samson, Gideon, Jephthah, and so on, all the heroes of the faith. We shouldn't panic because they are given to us. Their example is given to us to say they are just ordinary men used by God. Elijah, in James chapter 5, we are told, is a man like us, subject to the same temptations, subject to the same trials, subject to the same troubles of life. But they were mightily used by God to show us that we can achieve a pattern. So there is a pattern. They are set for us as examples so that we know there is an achievable pattern for each one of us as a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ. So tonight, I have chosen one of the least, maybe, the one which is not very often mentioned. We hardly know anything about him, Andrew. But even though we know very little about him, I believe he has a lot to teach us. A lot to teach us. Just his name Andrew, the name Andrew means manly, real man. It's interesting because even though it means manly, you find a feminized version of it. But he is just an ordinary man, used by God to accomplish extraordinary things. This is how we have to see all the Bible characters and every believer, every true believer following the Lord Jesus Christ. And we have so much about him as we read in the Word of God. He is from Bethsaida, with other disciples. They are all from Bethsaida, and Bethsaida means the house of fish, the house of fishermen, or the house of hunters. So they are from that small city. And when we read the gospel especially, we found that Andrew wrote no gospel. He wrote no letter. And we don't even have a recorded speech from Andrew. But he was mightily used by God, because it takes somebody like Andrew to find somebody like Peter. If it was not of Andrew, but we will come to that in a minute, if it was not of Andrew, we will never hear about Peter. So Andrew is the link, even though later Peter became the leader. Andrew is somebody who works in quiet places. Peter wins crowds, but Andrew wins individuals. One-to-one contact with people. Oh, the two men are brothers, but they are very different, completely different. In their character, in their temperament, they are different. But we don't find in the Word of God any time where there is a dissension or a quarrel between the two. And I believe, I have no verse to show you that, but I believe that Andrew has always been somebody dear to Peter. Why? Because if we hear about Peter, it's because Andrew has been that link. The man who brought him, who introduced him to the Lord, and that he could hear the Lord Jesus Christ. And they get along very well. The name Andrew is mentioned only 13 times in the New Testament, but his brother Peter more than 150 times. And with Andrew, in all the synoptics, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, he's present in every list. All the lists of the apostles, we find Andrew in them. And in Matthew and Luke, he's always on second position. Unfortunately or fortunately, he is always called Peter's brother. It's hard to be someone else's brother. It's hard to be someone else's sister, father, or mother. But this is how Andrew was always presented, just someone else's brother. And I remember a few years ago, we have received the visit of a young lady. We know her dad. Her dad is a friend. But everywhere she went in the country for people to welcome her, she has always been presented as the daughter of such. And once she called us, she said, "Why can't I be accepted for myself? Why do you have always to present me as the daughter of such?" And I had to tell her that culturally to us, you are nobody. Your dad is somebody to us. So I feel this is exactly what is happening with Andrew. It's like he's nobody, but the brother. He's the brother of Peter. But always number two in Matthew and in Luke. But when you read the Gospel of Luke, there he appears as number four. So he's even put in a lower position. He's not anymore in that inner circle of John, James, and Peter. So he's put now on number four. But it's interesting how he was saved himself. Because in order for him to be a link to Peter, he must have had that relation with the Lord Jesus Christ first. So before he met the Lord Jesus Christ, Andrew was a disciple of John the Baptist. And when you read John chapter 1 here, actually the whole gospel, this chapter, the whole chapter here is really a recorded sermon or address of John the Baptist, as we have read most of it, witnessing to his disciples. But very soon, John and Andrew and Peter and Philip and Nathaniel, they left John the Baptist and they went to the Lord Jesus Christ. Because you remember what John said? He must decrease. John must decrease and the Lord Jesus Christ must increase. So the conversion of Andrew happened with a direct relation with the Lord Jesus Christ when he heard John chapter 1 verse 29 repeated in John chapter 1 verse 36, "Behold the Lamb of God." So he heard the message of the Lord Jesus Christ through John the Baptist. So on that day, both of them, even though John does not mention himself at all in the text here, seven times when you read the Gospel of John, in a very discreet way, John presents himself. So here, with Andrew, John, both together, they followed on that day the Lord Jesus Christ, and they dwell with him, and they heard the word of God, and he explained to them who he is and why he came. But on that day, Andrew didn't spend the whole day with the Lord. He went back. He went back fishing, actually. But first of all, you remember I said there was a first step where he found a relational calling with the Lord Jesus Christ. But later, he went back to fishing, and the Lord spent a whole night in prayer. Then he chose the 12. And among the 12, he gave them that vocational calling. Not the relational calling, but the vocational calling. So both of them, John, Andrew, Peter, and you know the names of the 12 disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ, and Andrew was one of them. But just to show you, I don't want to dwell too long on this, but there is a progressive understanding from the disciples about whom the Lord Jesus Christ is. And as you look at John chapter 1 here, it appears very clear. The first thing, when they met with the Lord Jesus Christ, in verse 38, they called him Rabbi, which means just master or teacher. That's the way they related to the Lord Jesus Christ. Whom was he to them at the first contact? Just a teacher. But very soon, in verse 41, there is a progression. Not just a teacher, not just the master from whom we could receive knowledge, from whom we could receive informations, but in verse 41, we have found the Messiah. So there is a progression. Teacher, Messiah. Messiah, the anointed one, the chosen one. And going back to the Old Testament, only three people were chosen, were anointed on that aspect. Kings, priests, and prophets. And you find all the three offices in the Lord Jesus Christ. He is our king, he is our prophet, but he is also our high priest. And the third progression now, from a teacher, they found him as the chosen one, the anointed one. And if you look, verse 49, now he is the Son of God. Son of God. That's the most wonderful confession a sinner could make, that indeed the Lord Jesus Christ is the Son of God. He is the Son of God, being the one who came from God. Who is he? He is God, God himself. So that's a wonderful progression in the understanding of Andrew, but also of the other disciples. So Andrew was a soul winner. He won souls for the Lord Jesus Christ, and he's an introducer. He introduced always people to the Lord Jesus Christ. But before I explain more, there are some instances as I said, he's an introducer. And the first one to mention, when you go back to Mark chapter 1, Peter's mother-in-law was sick. And in that chapter, we find that the Lord Jesus Christ healed many people. And when the Lord came to Peter's house, actually that house in Capernaum was described as being his house, his home, and the city of Capernaum itself being described as his city. So once he entered in the house, in that house, bear this with me, Andrew and Peter, both of them introduced to the Lord Peter's mother-in-law. And you remember, the Lord healed her, and she woke up and served the Lord. So that's one example of Andrew introducing again somebody to the Lord, and the Lord did a mighty work into that person's life. But another example before I explain more again, that we find is just to show there are not many instances where Andrew is mentioned, but at least there are some. And then when you read in Mark chapter 13, verse 3, 1 to 3, you will find now Andrew is among the quatuor, the four greatest apostles of the Lord. And now they were with the Lord asking him privately, when are the things about the end of this world are going to take place? So you find Andrew asking that very important question. But in order to know more about Andrew, the Gospel of John is the best gospel where we find a lot about him, a lot of descriptions. And there are three instances I would like to study with you tonight, which again will confirm what we have already said to show that indeed Andrew is a soul winner. And remember, we are taking his example as a pattern that we too, we can be soul winners. That's the relation we have to make between us and Andrew. But it's interesting, with the three instances, you will find that Andrew became the first home missionary and the first foreign missionary. So that's wonderful. Maybe up till now you have neglected Andrew, but I hope at the end of this study you will dig more, trying to know who he is and what he has done for the Lord Jesus Christ. So I want to take you to those three instances just in the gospel. So we will limit ourselves to the Gospel of John. I have mentioned already how he introduced somebody in Mark chapter 1, Peter's mother-in-law. He introduced a question with other disciples in Mark chapter 13. But in the Gospel of John, there are three instances where we find him introducing somebody to the Lord Jesus Christ all the time. So I will not go in order because I want to come back to John chapter 1 later where we will draw some applications. And hopefully the applications will make us not to panic again, that what the Lord has done with Andrew, he can do it with each one of us belonging to the Lord Jesus Christ. So the first instance in our order tonight is from John chapter 6. John chapter 6. John chapter 6. And I'm sure as soon as John chapter 6 is mentioned, you know this is the miracle or the multiplication of bread where 5,000 men were fed with five loaves and two fish. So as you read John chapter 6, verse 5 to 15, we will not read the text, but because it's a very well-known text, you can see that this record is not accidental. And I'm sure it is given to us with a purpose, because Andrew called attention to a boy, a young lad, who had five loaves and two fish. But when you read the text in John chapter 6, verse 5 to 15, you will see Philip was more worried about the financial implications, about the crowd being there the whole day, and they are hungry, they are tired, they are overwhelmed with all what was happening. But Andrew looked at what is available. So he didn't look at the financial implications of what is available, Because he thought, this is just impossible. We could never help and feed so many people because we don't have enough money. That's how he looked at it. But Andrew looked at what is available. Five, there is a young lad here. What does he have? Five breads, two fish. Oh, you may think, I'm sure you may think with such a crowd that Andrew is naive. But the lesson here, he brought up what was available. This is what, no matter how small it is, this is what is available. No matter how small we are, we made ourselves available to the Lord. And you go back, we have no time to go into it, but you go back to the Old Testament, we remember with Moses, what happened with Moses? The Lord asked him, what do you have in your hand? And what did he have in his hand? This is, by the way, in Exodus chapter 4. And Moses said, a rod, just a stick. That's, if you read Exodus chapter 4, verse 2, Moses said, I have a rod. But in Exodus chapter 4, verse 20, that Moses' rod became something else. It became the rod of God. It's not the rod of Moses anymore, but now it belongs to God. So small as it is, but the Lord has mightily used it. And that's what we should bear in mind. And just think about the blessedness when we too, we introduce a sinner to the Lord. That's our responsibility. In the same way that Andrew has introduced this young lad with his five loaves and two fish, it is also our responsibility to introduce, no matter how small we are, no matter how prominent we are, but our responsibility is to introduce a sinner, a soul to the Lord Jesus Christ. And I believe Andrew believed that the Lord could do great things with something small. Do you believe in that? Just look at our number, so small compared to this great city. But through us, the Lord can accomplish great things. And it's our responsibility again to present sinners unto him. Conversion is a miracle, like the multiplication of the breads. It is a miracle because God changes the heart, the mind, and the will of a man. Andrew pictures the faithful servant, and I'm sure the young lad will never forget what happened to him that day. We too will never forget the day of our conversion, when the Lord has mightily worked in our hearts. My brothers and sisters, little is much when the Lord is in it. So small things can be great when the Lord uses them. So that's the first, you can, for time's sake, I didn't read the text, but I just sums it up. I have just put it together for us to draw your attention on that first instance. And this is something great done because Andrew took that step. And he said, there is a young lad. This is what he has, no matter how small it is. And a great miracle happened on that day. The second instance is in John chapter 12. And again here, I will just sum it up because you know the text. And this is what led me to say, Andrew became the first foreign missionary. And in John chapter 12, the reading is from verse 20 to 22. And here we find some Greek tourists. Let's call them, they were just tourists coming into the city of Jerusalem. And the first person to whom they spoke was Philip. But, you know, Philip, we could do another study on his character. Philip was a very reserved person. And you can see him in John chapter 6, but also here in John chapter 12. He's a reserved person. When the Greeks came to ask him, we want to see the Lord, he didn't have that courage, so he was not so bold to take the men before the Lord. What did he do? He went and spoke with Andrew. And Andrew was again the link. He became the introducer, the one who took them to present them before the Lord. And as you know in the text, this is where the Lord gave one of his greatest teaching, not only to his disciples, but to those Greeks. And he said about his death, but also about his resurrection, using the analogy of a seed. For a seed to bear fruits, what should happen? It must be buried, it must die, and it will blossom up. And that's what happened with the Lord Jesus Christ. He died, but he also raised from the dead. But before I come to the third instance, it's just to give you now the end of the life of Andrew. We don't know much about the end of his life. Actually, the last time Andrew's name is mentioned is in Acts chapter 1, verse 14 and 15, where we find him with the other disciples. The Lord has ascended, and now they are in the upper room doing what? In prayer. So that's the last instance where the name of Andrew is mentioned. Now, we have the traditions are telling us many things about Andrew. A tradition says that he traveled and he went to Greece, and there he preached the gospel for many years, but he was persecuted and he was caught. And when he was caught, he was crucified, and he was crucified on an X-shaped cross. And the tradition again says that for 3 days, suffering on that cross, but he was still witnessing about the Lord Jesus Christ. And not going into all the other details, but we are told even today that Scotland and Russia have him as their patron saint. So he is somebody well respected even nowadays in church history. But now, going back to John chapter 1, as I have promised, this is where really I want to draw more applications and to show you what should be the life of a soul winner. What is the pattern we could learn from the life of Andrew as a soul winner? And my brothers and sisters, we love doctrine. We love the word of God. We live by the word of God. But we should never lose sight with the importance of having that zeal, that passion to win souls for the Lord Jesus Christ. Remember in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, the Lord said, "You shall be my witnesses." We are his disciples, but we are also his witnesses, and we are soul winners. Every Christian should be a soul winner. So in relation to John chapter 1, verse 40 and 41, this is where I would like to draw five things. There are five things mentioned there which we can apply to ourselves as soul winners. And they are so simple, but the text is pregnant of great spiritual truth, which we can, as I said, apply to every soul winner. And the first thing in verse 40 is that, you may take this for granted, or it's so obvious, but never take it for granted. The first thing for a soul winner, he must find the Lord. There is no, and this is the problem we have in so many churches. People are trying to win souls, not according to the biblical method, not according to the way it is done in the Bible, but according to their own ways. But the first step to be a soul winner, what happened to Andrew here in verse 40, one of the two which heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. In verse 41, he first findeth his own brother Simon and said unto him, "We have found the Messiah." So that's the great, for a soul winner, he must find the Lord Jesus Christ for himself. My brothers and sisters, you cannot give what you don't have. And you cannot contaminate other people with what didn't contaminate you, if that's a positive way of saying it. Which means we pass on, we give to other people what we ourselves have experienced. We have found the Lord, not gold, not silver, not a hidden treasure, not a pearl. Oh, the greatest pearl, of course, is to find the Lord Jesus Christ. But that's the message. What do you have? We have found the Lord Jesus Christ. So for a soul winner, to be a soul winner, he must be a Christian. He must be a believer. He must be born again. He must find the Lord. And there is no other way to start with. And in Mark chapter 1, verse 17, because they have found the Lord, in that text the Lord said, follow me and I will make of you fishers of men. So that's the first thing we see with Andrew. He became a fisher of men because he has found the Lord. And the second, in the same verse again, oh, this is wonderful. Every word in verse 41 is important, and hopefully I will show that. Every word there. The first thing he did, that word first, underline it, please. It's a very important word. When one finds the Lord, the natural inclination of a renewed heart is to find someone else to whom to pass it on. So he has found the Lord, first step, and the first thing which comes to his mind is to do something about it. And that's wonderful. It is a test of true Christian experience. Andrew saw the urgency. He saw the spiritual immediacy of his calling. It's not just to enjoy being with the Lord, because some people, they meditate, oh, how nice it is to be with the Lord, to read his word, to grow spiritually and so on, but there is the going. The going is lacking, and that was not the case of Andrew. So the first thing he did is really to find someone else to whom he could pass the message. Before reaching the crowds, please, we must reach one. One brings one. There is no better method. One brings one. And we can see that with Andrew. That's the best pattern he gives us. One enlightened torch lights other torches. That's the way it should be for the church and for believers. This is how the gospel goes out. It is biblical, it is simple, it works, and it doesn't need you to be an expert on evangelism to do it. One has found the Lord, the first thing he thinks about someone else to pass the message. So the blessing we keep just for ourselves will never prosper. And that is not only about evangelism, but every spiritual gift we receive from the Lord, we keep it just for ourselves, it will never prosper. And I have, maybe it's a digression here, but there is no private gift. 1 Corinthians 11 says, all gifts are given for the church, the building of the church. If it's just for you, that's selfish. It's not a gift. So Andrew have understood the importance of passing the message to other people. He thought about someone else. So the third, and it's again in the verse there, verse 41. He first findeth. That's the verb there. So he finds someone else. As soon as he finds the Messiah, he goes. And we do not know how far he went, do we? To find Peter, we do not know that. But the most important thing, that word tells us that every man, every woman who has not found the Lord is lost and must be found. Even in just in that verb, we can see the lostness of men and women without the Lord Jesus Christ. And hopefully, later you can do a study for yourself on that. You will see the pattern. There is a pattern there. Andrew finds Peter. The Lord finds Philip. Philip finds Nathanael. That's the pattern you find in John chapter 1 here. And I believe, again, I don't have a verse to show you and to prove that. But I believe in the same way that Andrew has found Peter, John found whom also? His brother, James. Because later the two will become so close, and they become even in the inner circle of the Lord Jesus Christ, Peter, John, and James. So you can see the one-to-one, one brings one, and it is so wonderful. And this is how things should be done. So each one of us was found by someone. And that's why I believe we should have great respect for our spiritual fathers. Unfortunately, nowadays, you see, there is a tension between many spiritual sons with their spiritual father. But that should never be the case. We should be indebted to that person the Lord has used to bring the gospel to us. So the gospel is the greatest gift and the greatest offer we can give and a man can get. There is no other something better than the gospel. Because of Andrew, Peter became not the first pope, but the first elder, the first pastor, the first shepherd of the church. And the shepherd, of course, the Lord himself being the great shepherd. The fourth one. I know time is going, but the fourth one in verse 41. He first findeth whom? His own brother. His own brother. They are blood brothers, same father, same mother, but there is something even greater now. That blood relation becomes the spiritual relation. And there is nothing greater than that spiritual relation, that we become one and God becomes our heavenly Father. So evangelism is to win my brother at home. It starts at home, at uni, at our workplace, in the neighborhood. And this is the pattern we find with Andrew. And you remember the demon-possessed man called Legion. When the Lord healed him, he said to him, go and tell your house. Go and tell your house. He wanted to follow the Lord, but go and tell. So go and tell at your house. Tell the people of your house. And Spurgeon, we are told, Spurgeon, after preaching a sermon on the duty of personal witness of every believer, a man was deeply convicted when he heard the sermon. So after the service, he went to Spurgeon asking for an advice to be able to use and to join the outreach team. And in his wisdom, Spurgeon said to him, what is your job? And the man said to him, I'm a steam locomotive engineer. And Spurgeon said to him, is the fireman of your train converted? And the man said, no, but what has this to do with my question? Spurgeon looked at him and said to him, that's your piece of work. So one-to-one, where you work or at home, you can find that person to whom to witness. And lastly, in verse 41 again, we can see he first findeth his own brother Simon and said unto him, he spoke. He didn't give him a lecture, but he spoke about the Lord. And he said to him, we have found the Lord. The same message they heard John the Baptist preaching, they were also able to communicate it to other people. And Andrew communicated a simple message to Peter. My brothers and sisters, we speak what we know, and we speak about the things we have seen. But remember, in being a soul winner, you don't have to wait to know everything. You don't have to wait until you have all the answers. Nobody has all the answers. We go with the little we know. What do we know? I have found the Lord. You remember the blind man in John chapter 9, when the religious people were pushing him to the wall? What did he say? They asked him, is the Lord a prophet? Is he the Son of God? Who is he? What did he say? I do not know. But one thing I know, I was blind, but now I see. That's the simple. So sometimes we think about a lecture. I have a friend. He's so good in contact, but he spoils it. In 5 minutes, he wants to go from Genesis to Revelation. He spoils the matter. But make it simple, always. Give your testimony. I have found the Lord. And there is no greater sermon than that in a one-to-one contact. And we remember the Samaritan woman. She went. When she met with the Lord, she said, she went back to her village and she said, come and see a man who told me all that I did in my life. He knows everything. And later, the people of the village told her, we believe not because you told us, but now we can see it for ourselves. Isn't that amazing? That now we see it for ourselves. So this is a good pattern. And the most important is that people could say for themselves, we have found the Lord. My brothers and sisters, as I close, the verbal proclamation of the gospel brings faith. Romans 10, verse 17. Faith comes by hearing. And what we hear from the word of God, from the word of the Lord Jesus Christ. And proclaiming the truth can involve giving the same message, but also saying the same things over and over again. Can you see John repeated twice, behold the Lamb of God which taketh away the sins of the world. He had to repeat it for people to understand it. So sometimes we have to repeat the same things for people to grasp the message of the Lord Jesus Christ. Here is my conclusion. It is taken from Proverbs 11, verse 30, where it says, he that winneth souls is wise. Do we want to be wise men, wise women? We have to be involved in soul winning. A soul winner is a fisher of men, not a selfish man. And Andrew has experienced the preciousness of a soul. A soul is precious. My brothers and sisters, never neglect the one-to-one interaction with sinners. That's the most blessed method we find through the testimony and the witness of Andrew. May the Lord give us the gift of contact, but also may the Lord give us the tact, not just the contact, but the tact, to bring sinners to be reconciled with the Lord Jesus Christ and to reverberate his glory and his kingdom. Oh, can I read just those two verses again? One of the two which heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first findeth his own brother Simon and saith unto him, we have found the Messiah, which is being interpreted the Christ. We have found the Lord Jesus Christ.